Hello, and welcome to Central Booking, where writers and readers are the authority. I'm your host, John Valeri. Today on Central Booking, award-winning author M.K. Graff. Graff penned the critically acclaimed Nora Tierney English Mysteries, the most recent of which is The Evening's Amethyst. A journalist and beloved children's author, Nora is an American transplant in Oxford and can't resist the call of truth, particularly on behalf of friends and family. When her stepsister becomes a person of interest in the mysterious death of an Exeter College student, Nora is on the case, along with her fiancé, D.I. Declan Barnes. Soon, a perplexing question arises. Who is Verity? Finding the answer may just be the death of them. Graff's background as a registered nurse was grounded in her love of words. In addition to writing features for Nursing Spectrum, she also edited a nursing journal and later became a consultant for television and film projects, working on scripts and overseeing medical scenes on Manhattan-based sets. Having transitioned to writing full-time, she now authors two mystery series, the aforementioned Nora Tierney novels, as well as the Trudy Genova Manhattan mysteries, which were inspired by her experiences working behind the scenes in the entertainment industry. Her other credits include screenplays, short stories, essays, and poetry. Additionally, Graff is managing editor of Bridal Path Press. The Evening's Amethyst was recently named a finalist for Killer Nashville's Silver Falchion Award for Best Cozy. British novelist Nicola Upson called the book a fine addition to a wonderful series, noting Graff delivers her trademark blend of compelling mystery, vivid setting, and engaging characters. Now, M.K. Graff tells us just how she laces her potent, sharp-as-needles books with insight and intrigue.
Hi, everybody. Welcome back to Central Booking. I am excited to be in the virtual company of M.K. Graff tonight, who is an award-winning author. Her newest release is The Evening's Amethyst. Beautiful cover, very evocative title. And this book is actually now a finalist. Let me see if I can get this correctly, for the Killer Nashville Silver Falchion Award and also a Reader's Choice Award. So welcome to the show, Marnie, and congratulations on those nominations.
Well, thank you very much, John. I was sort of surprised myself. They didn't send me an email until the following day. A friend of mine saw it posted on their website and sent it to me. So I was really tickled for that. And it's always nice to be, you know, feel that your books are being read and noticed and appreciated. That's very nice.
Absolutely.
Thank you.
That's a nice surprise to get. That's a good email to read. So The Evening Amethyst. So this is, you know, Nora book number 5 already. But I have to ask you, readers are very lucky because we actually get two mysteries here. So I'm wondering if briefly you can tell us what the two central mysteries are to this book, and then we'll break it down a bit more specifically.
So the overarching mystery that kicks off the book is a death of a young student who's a master's student at Exeter College, where Nora's stepsister is a student also. And Nora lives in Oxford with her fiance and young son. And her sister calls her with a frantic phone call. Please come. You know, my best friend has been found at the bottom of the staircase. But as the person who has found the body, of course, Claire, which is her name, is an immediate suspect. And the question becomes, this woman, B. Jones, who seemed to have everything to live for, was it an accident? Did she fall? Did she jump? Did she commit suicide? Or conceivably, was she pushed? And then the other thread that goes along is a cold case. And the cold case is kidnapping from 20 years ago when a young toddler was kidnapped from outside a pub, and that's never been resolved. And it comes into the modern time, even though there are some flashbacks that explain how it happened, when a young man walks into Nora's fiance, as I said, is an Oxford detective, into St. Aldate Station and announces he thinks he might be this young boy who was kidnapped. And so the cold case then becomes a little bit more active. So those are the two main plots.
Yeah, those are two great hooks. I mean, you're lucky if a book gives you one great hook, but I was ensnared immediately. And so I have to ask you, sure. I love the setup because, you know, we have, as you mentioned, Nora's, I guess it would be stepsister, Claire, is a friend to the victim, but she also is potentially a suspect because she was there when the body was discovered. So I'm wondering if you can tell me, you know, how this necessitates Nora's involvement and also how it sort of legitimizes her sleuthing, because she is not a detective. She's an amateur detective, but she's also a children's book author. So you have to find sort of a believable way to bring her into a case, if you could speak to that.
Right. And I mean, what could be more believable than for your stepsister who she drops the step very quickly because they're getting to know each other better and neither one of them have a sibling. And so, you know, by the middle of the book, she's just introducing her as my sister. And when your sister calls you and says, please come help me. My friend has been found dead. I know she couldn't have committed suicide. Please help me prove that. So that's part of the thread. And then on the other hand, Nora knows from living with a detective that her sister is a suspect because she is the person who found the body. So she's anxious to clear her sister. So there are two things sort of at play there that to me were a believable enough reason for her to stick her nose in. Although it doesn't take a lot for Nora to stick her nose in places if she's interested in the case, because she was a journalist before she was a children's book author. So she lies very conveniently at the drop of a hat to get herself into interviews and to people. She feels that she has a good feel for human nature and she's very inquisitive. And so those things that made her a good journalist add to her being an amateur sleuth.
Sure. And so let me ask you to expand sort of on her relationship with D.I. Declan Barnes as well, because as you mentioned, you know, they live together, they're engaged to be married, and their dynamic has changed a bit over the years. It's evolved.
Yes.
So can you talk about the evolution of that relationship and how his views of her investigative work have changed as their relationship has progressed?
Dramatically changed. When he is first introduced in the first book, The Blue Virgin, Nora is an annoyance to him. She is someone who is nosy and pokes her nose in where it doesn't belong. And he sees her basically as an irritant. And maybe by the end of the book, he has a little begrudging idea that, oh, maybe she was right in a few areas, but she mostly annoys the hell out of him in the first book. And then in book two, he's mostly absent. She has moved to the Lake District. She's living there. And they vicariously only communicate a little bit. And at the end of the book, he makes an appearance and she realizes that, there's something a little bit more here than I thought the first time. By book three, when that one opens, the dynamic has changed. And in the intervening months, it's about 6 months later, because of that meeting at the end of book two, they have developed a correspondence, a long-term correspondence. So for 6 months, they've been talking on the phone, but mostly they've been writing emails back and forth. And I think it's very true that if you write letters, which emails basically are, you reveal a lot of yourself that way. And she feels that she's come to know him perhaps on a different level than she might have if they'd just been sitting in a room talking to each other. And you're also, by not having the person there that you're looking at, maybe you reveal yourself a little more, you share a little bit more. Sorry. So I think by book three, there's an obvious attraction between them. They start a relationship. And by book four, they're solidified as a couple. And they are not living together, but they're basically spending most of their nights together at either her rented place or his rented place. And at the end of that book, she impulsively buys this house in Oxford and decides she's going to move back to Oxford and stay there. And an engagement follows. So in terms of a story arc, the next book, book six, opens with their wedding. And I'm not giving anything away by telling you that, insider knowledge, but the bulk of the action takes place on their honeymoon and it will take place in Cornwall. And I have a folder and I have ideas and I sort of have the thread of a plot in my mind, but I'm working on my other series right now. So I haven't started writing that book yet. So in terms of how he feels about her, it's by this book that you just read, The Evening's Amethyst, that they're living together now, that he has come to respect her intuition and her feel for human nature. And he doesn't see her so much as an irritant, but as someone who perhaps could seriously help him as long as she's not putting herself in danger. He has sort of a begrudging respect for her a little bit more. So I think that reflects perhaps more the reality of what would happen if you were living with a professional detective and you were a nosy person who wanted to get involved in his cases.
Sure. I know, I love their dynamic, and, you know, he's a good man and he has realized, yes, I should probably trust her instincts a bit. She really knows what's right. going on, and she can relate to people in a way that he might not be able to, you know, which is kind of terrific fun. And I wanted to ask you about the setting too, because here much of the book is set at, as you said, Exeter College. So sort of the world mm-hmm. of academia, which is its own sort of unique insular place. And I'm wondering if you can speak to that, because I know that it's been, you know, big in fiction in recent years, but it gives you a lot to play with. And it's kind of a fun and unique backdrop to use for a story like this.
I know you think of Cambridge and Grantchester or Endeavor and Morse with Oxford, right? I mean, that is just the classic settings. But really for me, I was fortunate enough to study at Exeter one summer, studied Gothic literature. So I knew the layout of the college and I was familiar with it. And I went there knowing, before the first book was written, knowing that I was probably going to set my series in England. And having been there and taken pictures and lived there for a summer, I knew that that would be the place that eventually a mystery would be set there. And indeed, the very first book is set in Oxford, but only Exeter is only seen in a few scenes. But in this one, I wanted to sort of make Exeter be the setting star, if you will. And I think that closed community, I mean, think about it, in a university setting like that, you have all the same petty jealousies you would have in a family. You have that closed setting of a community. You have a very rigid caste system. Only the dons are allowed to walk on the quad. The students aren't allowed to. So there's all of these rules, and they even have scouts still in Oxford, which are basically housekeepers. And at one point I have Declan's sergeant, who thinks it's just absolutely absurd, bring that up and say, I mean, it's ridiculous. These people are, you know, in their 20s and they're still having someone come in and empty their garbage and bring them tea in the morning. And I mean, he just thinks it's absurd. So I think that there's a great delight in sort of that insular world that people on the outside would like a look, a glimpse into. And so it was, you know, for me, it was a no-brainer that I would eventually set a book at Exeter, particularly.
Sure. Yeah, I mean, it's great fun to read, and you definitely have a different perspective as an outsider versus somebody who's actually sort of living in that system. And I thought I'd ask you too, I mean, Nora Tierney is obviously your protagonist, your main character, but what I love is even though she is that central focus of the books, you switch points of view throughout the book. And you also, as you mentioned previously, there are some elements of the past at play here. It doesn't overwhelm the narrative, but there are, you know, excerpts of past events that play into present day events. And I'm wondering if you can talk about what your process is like to account for those complexities, because it's not a straightforward story when you do it that way. So how do you account for that? And how do you think it benefits the overall narrative?
I think that the when you introduce a cold case like that, and now you're having people take a new look at it, you know you're going to have those contemporary scenes. But I feel that in order to have the reader become engaged with what happened for something 20 years ago, you have to understand the personalities and the people that were involved. I mean, it's human nature that we're drawn to in terms of the characters. And the only way to really get inside the head of the person who is the kidnapper was to have some scenes from his point of view, even if they're minor scenes. And actually I started the book off with a Nora scene as I usually do. And I decided that because this one was different and had a cold case, that I changed it and I put, it's almost like a prologue, but it's really the first scene in the book is the kidnapper and him. You see what goes through his mind and how he convinces himself that this is a reasonable thing to do. And that is at the heart of a lot of the mysteries that I write. I'm fascinated by the idea of what, other than the one book that has a psychopath in it, most of my other murderers, if you will, are what you would call it the average person in a book. And I'm fascinated by what makes a person, a human, feel it's reasonable to cross that line to kill somebody, how they justify that to themselves. And so I just sort of applied that same logic here. What would make a person feel that it's reasonable for him to kidnap this child, to take someone else's child and bring it into his home and raise it as his own? And so that was where I started from for that. And I do have just a few scenes from his wife's point of view, but they're mostly from his point of view. And I think that helps explain the situation a little bit more when you get to the contemporary scenes. And so I always knew I was going to have them sort of sprinkled in between. And yeah, and I work with a wonderful writing group. We've worked together now for 17 years. And we workshop our first drafts with each other. And I'm the only mystery writer. They write other types of novels. But what we do is we read our first drafts in May, and then we get together for a week in June, usually at each other's houses. We move around the country. And we've read through the drafts, and we bring hard copies that we've read and commented on and edited. And it was the other colleagues who said, you know, that they thought that I actually should plump up. I only had two or three scenes from that kidnapper's point of view, and they felt I could use a few more. They felt that that he was enough of a character and it played an important enough part that readers would be interested there. So I tried not to hit the reader too much over the head with that, but I was very careful about where I placed them, and it sort of breaks up the action of the contemporary investigations that are happening. So that was a very deliberate choice on my part, and it's always helpful when you have really good critiquers who know your work, and you get someone else's opinion to say, yeah, you can do that, you can even do it maybe a little bit more. So I was happy with how it came out, but it was a deliberate choice. And as far as the other points of view, they're mostly Nora and Declan, because Nora's the main character, and I would say Declan is the secondary main character. But there are, you know, some other people who are characters and have a lot to intersperse, like the family of the dead girl. And I think it's important, again, to humanize these people, not necessarily because they're suspects per se, but because they add texture to the book and they make the reader care about that world, about that you've created this fictional world. And it's got to be peopled with real people. And in order to make them real, I think sometimes you have to be inside their heads a little bit. Now, in the other series that I write, the Trudy books, I don't do that as much. I'm very particular about staying more in Trudy, and she's written in first person, and her detective friend who has just recently become a boyfriend, Ned, is NYPD, and he is written in third person. And very rarely will I have a scene from someone else's point of view. It's mostly just the two of them going back and forth. So that's a little different. I think that these have a little bit more classic feel to them. I'm greatly influenced by Masterpiece Mystery. I watch far too many episodes of all of the old things. And as a matter of fact, I've just decided that I'm researching now. I'm going to do a standalone set in 1926. And I'm not sure where in writing these two series that will fall, but it's going to be, the working title for that is 11 Days. You're the first person to hear this. I don't know if it'll stay the title, but it takes place in December 1926 during the 11 days that Agatha Christie was at a Harrogate spa when she disappeared. But right. She's not the main character. The main character is a maid who worked there who has changed her identity and is running away from hiding from her family for very terrible reasons. And so she comes across Agatha Christie, but Agatha Christie is really a sort of subsidiary character to it. So that's something that I'm playing with. So I think I'm going to do that down the road. Anyway. And I don't know yet. Yeah, does that sound like a good premise? Do you think you'd read that book?
Oh my gosh. Yeah, I mean, I love Agatha Christie, and the mystery of where she went and what became of her during those 11 days is so intriguing. And so many people have reimagined it, some well and not so well, but I love that you're, you know, putting the focus on a different character. That's, again, way to keep it fresh. Right. But yes, I will be the first person to read that book.
All right. Well, if any of your viewers are interested in what I consider to be the best biography about Agatha Christie and the best explanation of what probably really drove her to that, it's by Laura Thompson. And it's just called Agatha Christie. It's a fat tome. Don't let it put you off. It's highly footnoted. The footnotes are just as much fun to read. But she was given access to Agatha Christie's letters. She spoke to her daughter, Rosalind. She has a lot of background information that the estate gave her, and the grandson, Matthew, you know, gave her access to. And I found her explanation of what probably drove her to that the most believable.
That's terrific. I have that book sitting in my stacks, and it's just been calling to me. And now I'm going to have to bump it up.
Really? I loved it. I, you know, every once in a while you have to intersperse, because I read, I would say 90% crime books and fiction, and you have to intersperse that with, you know, something else and keep yourself fresh. And it's good to read other things also. And so a good friend of mine, Nicola Upson, I don't know if you're familiar with her, but she writes historicals. It's the Josephine Tay series. And Josephine Tay is the main character, and those I highly recommend. But she recommended this book, and I had gotten a copy of it. And I'll tell you, I carried it around with me wherever I went. I couldn't put it down because it was just a fascinating, fascinating look into someone whose work I admire. I mean, the woman is only outsold by Shakespeare and the Bible. How do you, you know, how do you compare a writer's output to that? So.
Yeah, that's an.
We were talking about point of view, and somehow or other we got to Agatha Christie. But so I hope I didn't lead you too far astray there.
No, not at all. I mean, you know, you talk about mysteries. How can you not talk about Agatha Christie? But yeah, I guess I know what my next read is going to be, and that says something when you can say that. You know, the footnotes are almost as entertaining as the book itself. I'm like, all right, must read that one shortly. But all right, so we will bring it back to Nora, I suppose.
Okay.
And talk a bit more about your books. But I wanted to ask you too, one of the things, you know, that I love about series like this versus standalones is the domestic life, the domestic issues, the personal becomes almost as much, you know, almost as important as the professional. And there's really room to grow that throughout the books. So I was wondering if you wouldn't mind, you know, speaking to that, balancing the personal and the professional, and why it really is so important for the reader to be able to see the characters in their regular everyday life when they're not necessarily out investigating a crime.
I think it makes, again, we're back to the human nature thing. I think it makes readers understand that all of these people that you read about do have personal lives. And, you know, take Nora, for instance. She's a young mother. She's in a new house. They have a puppy. She has a toddler, and she freelances still for the magazine she used to write for, and she writes children's books. And she's juggling all of that with these amateur sleuthings, and still wants to feel like she's a good mom. You know, that she's not ignoring her child. So how do you balance that? And I think anyone who has raised a child or has a young child at home has that idea, understands that feeling that you have all these plates in the air or balls in the air that you're juggling all the time, and you hope that you're paying the right amount of attention to them all. And so I think that adds a layer of realism. And a lot of people say to me, oh, I love the food in your mm-hmm. books, because I talk a lot about, not a lot, but I do mention what the people eat, because we do eat. And yeah. So I don't describe every single meal that they have, and I may not show her cooking it, but when they sit down to dinner, I will tell you what they're eating. Because when you eat, that's something that families do together or that people do together. That's what we do in relationships. And I think food is something that everybody can relate to. So those sort of domestic details. You know, who's going to watch Nora's little boy while she goes to try to travel, take the bus to Woodstock to to try to worm her way into a suspect's house? Well, this is where, being a writer and playing the what-if game, you give her a very handy-dandy neighbor who happens to be the vicar of the church she lives next door to. And she and her husband have a little boy, and Nora's little boy, they two of them go to the same creche, which we would call a nursery school. And so the two women take turns picking the children up and dropping them off, and they have play dates. And so this gives Nora, you know, an hour or two where she can sneak away and not feel like she's ignoring her child, because she wouldn't be with him then anyway. So sometimes you have to be just as creative as real moms are in taking time for themselves. And I think those domestic details really can be mined for a very rich pot of gold, so to speak, because you're looking for universality in your books, something that readers can relate to. And who can't relate to having to worry about what you're going to feed your family for dinner, or who's going to watch your child, or, you know, housebreaking a puppy? My God, she saddles herself. They move into a new house and she's trying to housebreak a puppy. You know, but people do that. You know, they overload themselves sometimes. And then her sister calls and says, "You've got to help me." And how does she not help her? So I hope it strikes a balance there. And even with Declan, you know, he is a detective inspector, so he's achieved a certain rank, but his team is almost like a second family to him. His sergeant, who's his right-hand man, is expecting his first child. That's on his mind a lot. So certainly on the sergeant's mind a lot, but Declan wonders what he's going to do. He's been dangled the offer of a promotion, and he's not sure he wants it, because he likes being out in the field, and he would miss working with this chap. And so, you know, there's a lot of things at play that people face in their daily lives that maybe don't have anything to do with the mystery, but to me, make them more well-rounded characters.
Sure.
I hope that answers your question.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I kept asking myself, not only how is she going to, you know, solve this crime, but like you said, how is she going to take care of her kid and house train the dog and pick her paint samples and reshelf her books? It's just, it's a lot. But I loved it. And I love how you mentioned food, because I mean, it is its own sort of sensory experience. It evokes other elements of the senses. And then, you know, beautiful transitional point, but speaking about, you know, family and friendships, one of the overarching themes I found in this book is the fact that family is not just what we're born into, but what we make. And I find myself relating to that more and more, you know, the older I get. And I'm wondering if you can, you know, speak to that and how that plays into the book, because it's pivotal.
I think that, you know, in our Western culture, many years ago, it used to be that families kind of stayed near each other on the same block and took care of older generations. And that has something that has changed dramatically in the last, say, 50 years, 60 years. And Nora, for instance, she's an American, but she lives in England, and she probably, now that she's engaged and getting married to a fellow and has a child who has grandparents over there, probably will not be living in America again full time anytime soon. And so she sees her Connecticut family, and they make a brief appearance in this, and I refer to them, but those visits are few and far between. So she's had to surround herself, if you will, with a support system. She has a very good friend who we see a lot, who has been in every book, Val, who's an artist. Now she has a sister who's studying at Oxford and will be around for 2 years. And I think these extraneous ideas of family reach over and echo the theme of the person who kidnapped the child, because what he desperately wanted with his wife was a family. And so that sort of dovetails and ties in there, even down to a very small subplot of the cold case, when we're looking into the family of the boy who thinks he's the kidnapped boy and perhaps might or might not be. But his extended family in Scotland, he hasn't seen them in years. And so there's an opportunity there because of what's happening for them to reconnect. And, you know, I think that that's something, again, that people relate to, because your family is who the people who you surround yourselves with. And they're not always blood relations. They're the people whose company you enjoy, and they may know you well, but you can depend on them in a way, and they can depend on you in a certain way. And that's why I think families often include very close friends that are not blood relations. I mean, you don't get to choose your blood relations, but you do get to choose your friends. And so sometimes you can be closer to them than to family members who drive you crazy. Not that your friends don't drive you crazy, but your family's always going to drive you crazy in a different way. Does that make sense?
Absolutely. I think a lot of people are relating to that right now. I see heads shaking. Yes, I'm sure. So let me ask you too. I am a sucker for books, you know, that feature characters that have a background in writing. I love that. Or any subplots that involve literature or reading. And you have that here throughout the books because, you know, Nora's a reporter. She's also a children's writer. And then there's this whole idea of Roald Dahl and his books that Bea was studying at college. So I'm just wondering if you can talk about what of your own writing experiences you lend to Nora, and then how you build in other literary references as well for people like me who just find that really fun and fascinating in a book.
I think when I read a book, I'm always interested to learn things. And it could be about an area that you don't know about. For instance, in the Trudy books, she's a medical consultant for Moody's Movie Studio, which was my favorite real nursing job when I was a nurse. And so that gives people a behind the scenes look at that. But for Nora, being a journalist, being involved in things, she's always going to be drawn to a literary aspect of anything. And so when I made her sister be studying at Exeter for a master's, I decided that I wanted the victim to be a really great writer, someone whose loss the literary world would really feel. And indeed, her master's thesis is probably going to be published by Oxford University Press, and it centers on Roald Dahl. And he's someone whose work we're familiar with, and we think of him as, you know, Charlie and the Chocolate Factory and Matilda and all of these wonderful things. But there was a tremendous amount of controversy about him because he had tremendous anti-Semitic views. And a lot of people are not aware of that. And so if you can show writers or people too, and show their background and the work that this girl invested, you know, into his life, I think, again, that not just educates readers, not that I'm hitting over the head educating them, but in terms of being fascinating, I think that fascinates me. And I think, well, if I'm interested in the life of a literary person whose work I've admired, just like the Agatha Christie thing, maybe other people would be too. And for me, it's really as simple as that. If it interests me, I'm perhaps vain enough to think that maybe it will interest someone else too. And, you know, it's obviously to the point that I've chosen someone whose name is familiar to most people, and I don't spend a lot of time talking about it, him, but I spend enough time talking about him that you could learn a little bit about him that maybe you didn't know before.
Sure.
And, you know, in answering, yes, yeah, and in answering to that, you know, the part that makes it into the book, and you know this, John, is probably a fifth, a sixth of the research you do on a topic, if that. You know, I'm always told by my writing crew that my setting detail, I sound like, come off sounding like a travelogue in my first drafts. And that's, I have to cut that the most because I love old architecture and I love, you know, Oxford and England. I'm a real Anglophile. And so my descriptions tend to go on and on and on. And the girls have to say to me, we're really not interested in all of that. Just give us three or four lines. I'm like, three or four lines, you know, I'm like, don't you want to know that? And they're like, no, we really don't. So you do have to take other people's sensibilities into it. But I think in a literary sense, people are always interested in the backstories or lives of writers. I mean, writers are just people, aren't they? They're just people who decide to pursue their art in a certain way. And they have the good, the bad, and the ugly in their own lives.
Sure. And it's just, it's another dash that goes into a pot and it all comes together and you have like a really, really tasty stew. But I did want to follow up on something else that you mentioned as well, talking about how much you love to build setting. I mean, obviously, you have traveled abroad. This is not a foreign concept to you, but you do mainly live in America. So can you talk a bit about how you do create a really authentic sense of place? Because I mean, not only do you need to know places, but it's language, it's procedure. So it's a whole lot of stuff that you have to get right to satisfy basically two audiences.
That's true. That's true. And I'm very careful about that, I have to say. So my husband and I, before COVID, would travel to the UK every other year and do setting research for books down the road. So for instance, we've already been to Cornwall, and that book isn't even, on the horizon to be written, just the idea of it. But I'm hoping to be able to get back there in the spring. And so whenever I do travel to a place, I'm taking a lot of pictures. I've found over the years that postcards of the area are better sometimes than my pictures in terms of evoking an area for me. So I come home and they're easy to pack. They don't take up a lot of room in your suitcase. So I usually have a stack of postcards from an area. And then I have some good friends who are writers in England, and I call on them and I say, I'm coming over and I'm going to look at Cornwall. So for instance, the writer that I mentioned, Nicola Upson, and her partner, Mandy Morton, who's a BBC presenter and also writes her own series. I don't know if you can see these books here. This is Mandy's book. It's called The Number Two Feline Detective Agency.
Oh, I love it.
And it's a world of cats. Yes. And then they're very, very interesting. And then I'm trying to see Nicola's books. Nicola is the Josephine Tay series, and she they own a cottage in Cornwall called Strawtop. And we stayed at a bed and breakfast nearby, and they took me to the place where an old stone church that will be the setting for Nora's wedding. They took me to a wonderful place that I won't go into now. That's going to be where her small wedding party stays and where they have a reception before they go off on their honeymoon. And then Nora's writer friends are going to loan her and Declan their thatched cottage in Porthleven, which is this couple's cottage. It's called Strawtop. It's the last thatched cottage in Porthleven that's left. It's an old seamaster's cottage. And the idea is that when we went to dinner at their house, and I saw this tiny little cottage that they use as a sort of vacation home and where they write most of their books, because they live in Cambridge. They told me the story about they made me look how thick the plaster walls are. And the folklore in the town is that a sea captain who owned the house originally, when they would die, they would bury them sitting in a chair in these wide walls facing the sea that they could look out on what they loved. And that sparked the idea for Nora and Declan to spend a week at this borrowed cottage. And a body's going to be found in the wall, but a contemporary body. So that's all I know about the book so far. But obviously, that couple are going to be my contact people for anything to do with that. But I've stayed in the town. I've been there. I can describe the waterfront and the beautiful sunset. So that's one thing, is to visit a place. I would personally find it very difficult to write about a place I've never visited, even for a day or two. But that's me, because I love architecture and I think that you get this the sights and the sounds and even the smells of a place when you can physically be there. That being said, I don't live there. And the books are often written long after I've visited a place. So I always have contacts in an area. I have friends besides this couple who live there, and they're always my beta readers for the manuscripts. So they go through them and they look for what I call my Brit speak, because a lot of my slang terms are taken from Masterpiece Mystery or Colin Dexter or Agatha Christie. And a lot of the terms sometimes they're not contemporary, they're not used any longer. So they check me out on that. And then the third prong of that I found is if there's something particular that I need to know, I have always been able to find a contact by Googling someone, for instance, when I was setting a couple of books in the Lake District in Cumbria, which I adore and have traveled to often, but I'd never been to a police station there. I contacted the police station and I said, you know, for the mention of your name in the acknowledgments, is there someone there who would be willing to answer a few email questions? Well, they forwarded that on to a homicide detective who was retiring. And Steve Sharp, his name is, he lives in Australia now. And he and I ended up being great email friends. I've never met the man, but he helped me with three of my books, with settings down to describing the mortuary in Kendall, where, you know, a couple of scenes take place. And so I've never had a person turn me down when I've asked for information if I tell them I'll use their name in the acknowledgments of the book. Right. So you can, you know, really. And so, I mean, sometimes it'll be what's in bloom at a certain time of year. And one of my friends will tell me, you know, I try to do as much of the research as I can before I sit down to write, but you would be surprised, like that type of question will always come up as you're writing. And, you know, and so I try to make a list. And then before I start writing the next time, I've shot an email off to, say, Joyce in London. What, you know, it's April, what's, you know, it's May, what's blooming? What am I, you know, keep me on the straight and narrow here. And so they're very good about that. So, you know, if you don't know someone there, make yourself know someone there in your chosen setting. That would be my recommendation.
No, that's terrific. It's good.
And that's how we do it.
And who doesn't want to see their names, you know, in the acknowledgement section?
It's true. It's very hard to turn that down, isn't it?
Absolutely.
You know, as I said, I've never had a difficulty having someone answer my questions.
I feel like we all, you know, we want to feel like we know something. And then every once in a while, someone like you comes along and is actually interested in what it is that we know. And that makes you feel real good. And then if you get acknowledgement for it, it's even better.
Yeah. And I mean, you know, you can't possibly know everything.
No.
And you can certainly do some Google research on things, but it's always, I find it's always better to, if you can, talk to an expert in the field, who's, and as I said, people are extremely gracious and writers are very gracious to each other. So if you know someone who has already set a book in a certain place and you're going to move your book there, that's a mine to tap. I have never found a community as gracious and as generous as writers. And I think, and you must have come across that, right, in your work, that you see that. And I think that's born out of the idea that it's such a solitary profession. I mean, you're facing that blank page, that sea of white on a daily basis. And so writers are very happy to have a community where they can share and talk and exchange ideas. So, you know, I think that's extremely helpful. Yes, very, very much so. Very gracious people. Very gracious.
So let me ask you about your background too, because you briefly mentioned that you have a background in nursing, and then that actually allowed you to do some, you know, consulting on medical elements of television shows, which is really something fascinating that you can bring to your writing career. So would you mind just telling us a bit about that and how it's lent itself to what you do?
I always wrote and knew that at some point I wanted to be a writer. But I had this very good nursing career, as I said, for 30 years, but I always wrote on the side. And even when I was nursing, I wrote for a nursing journal. And so I did a lot of nonfiction work, but I studied all sorts of different, I studied poetry, I studied mysteries, I studied screenplay, which is how I knew the format. And then as I was sort of leaving nursing, getting ready to retire from that in order to write full time, I saw this ad in the paper for this movie studio. We lived on Long Island at the time, and they were looking for someone who knew screenplay format but was a nurse. And I am not what I would call a ballsy person, but I went to that interview and I said to the fellow, I said, I'm the person you want. Right. I said, you know, I have a strong nursing background. It was for medical consulting, for the medical scenes. But I studied and written two screenplays. I know screenplay format, and I got the job. And they would send me down to Law and Order, whatever was being filmed in New York at the time, for the medical scenes. Mostly I did soap operas and Because the cast gets used to having a certain person around. One Life to Live was the one that I did. And I worked there for probably 7 years. But, you know, it was only, again, here and there when they were having a medical scene. So I'd get a call on Monday and they'd say, we need you Tuesday and Thursday this week.
Right.
And I would take the train into the city and I would work for the day. Yeah. And it was a fascinating look. So then I start writing and I started with this crime series and I decided on mysteries for my novels because that's what I like to read the most. And I studied, I told you that summer in Oxford and I was gathering material and I was writing for a magazine, doing interviews with all the crime writers I adored. Val McDermid, Deborah Crombie, Ian Rankin, all these different people the magazine gave me access to. How wonderful was that, right? For someone who's getting ready to write their own novel. Yeah. So the magazine got in touch with me and she goes, you're in Oxford this month, right? And I'm like, yeah. And she says, I've arranged for you next week to take the train down to London to interview P.D. James.
Well,
P.D. James, I have to tell you, yeah. P.D. James was my, when you, if you have a hero, you know, a living hero in my lifetime, it was P.D. James. I absolutely adore her work and still do. And the fact that I was going to get to meet her was incredible. So without belaboring your audience, I'll just say that she was the most gracious person, gave me an hour and a half of her time for the interview. And I was so sorry to have to think that I was going to have to leave. And she said to me, do you have enough for your article? And I said, yes, but I really shouldn't take up any more of your time. And she said, well, if you're done with the article, she said, would you like a cup of coffee before you go? Would I? How would you not want that? I knew from researching her that she hand wrote all of her novels on that kitchen table that we were going to have a cup of coffee at. So she takes me downstairs at her London townhouse, was one of those tall, narrow townhouses, and sat me down and we started talking then. More personally. And when she heard that I worked, you know, and I was still doing it at the time that I wrote for this magazine, for this movie studio, she said, well, your English series sounds wonderful. She said, but after you feel you know how to write a book and you have sort of a few of them under your belt, she said, promise me someday you'll write another series about a nurse who does what you do because readers love a behind the scenes look at a world they don't know. So that's the Trudy Genova Manhattan Mysteries. And the first one is called Death Unscripted and it's dedicated to the Baroness, as I call her. And we ended up remaining friends for the last 15 years of her life. Wow. We corresponded. Every time I went to England, we had tea. And she was extremely gracious to me, and I was invited to her memorial service in England. I flew over for it. So, you know, that's something that I still can't believe I had her in my life. And that's how I met Nicola and Mandy, was at her memorial service. And we've been fast friends ever since because we had, you know, Phyllis in common. So you never know what is going to fall into your path. And I would just say, especially for a writer, to keep yourself open to possibilities of any kind, because you never know where it's going to take you. Now I alternate the writings and more, yeah, with the Trudies. Yeah. So that's what I'm working on right now is the third. Thank you. Thank you. Yeah. It was a wonderful experience having her in my life. I'm very grateful for it.
And isn't that a wonderful thing when people you look up to and then they end up being, you know, even better than you could have imagined? Because so many times, you know, you hear the event, don't meet your heroes because they don't live up to your expectations. But every once in a while, you know, you're completely surprised by people who absolutely surpass them. That's got to be the best feeling.
It was. And she was, like I said, she was so gracious with her time. She had a wicked sense of humor. You wouldn't know that about her when you know, think of Adam Dalgliesh in this, you know, sort of foreboding, withdrawn poet detective that she created. But she had a wonderful, very wicked sense of humor. She served on a lot of liturgical committees. She was very involved with the Anglican Church. And she had her assistant, Joyce, file all of those committee minutes under a file that was headed God. That's what she put it under. And, you know, we used to laugh about it. And she was just, she was a dear friend. And I was very, very grateful to have her in my life for that period of time.
Well, that's terrific. If T.D. James offers you a cup of coffee, I feel like forget the coffee cup, just bring the whole pot. That's amazing. But I can appreciate that.
You've met so many.
I've gotten to interview so many people that were heroes of mine, and some of them I now consider friends. And it's like, pinch me, that's wild. Like, I remember watching Marsha Clark prosecute the O.J. Simpson trial, and now we email all the time. And it's the most bizarre thing, because when I was a kid, like, it sounds weird, but like, she was my hero. And now I know her pretty well. And it's just like, mind blown,
Yes, exactly. It's that same type of feeling, like someone that you've looked up to, or that you've admired, and here they are sort of in your life. And it's fascinating. I just find it fascinating. And you just have to leave yourself open to, situations like that.
Yeah, absolutely. Sometimes, you least expect it, and then you're presented with these amazing, opportunities, and it's wonderful. And then you get to be the sponge, and you just try to soak up all this generosity that people are sharing with you. So I want to switch gears and ask you something completely different that I'm fascinated by. But you publish through Bridal Path Press, which is an independent press, but with a very active and discerning editorial board. You were part of that. And I wanted to ask you about that. Tell us about the press and how it is. How do you decide who and what you want to publish?
So the press is out of Baltimore, and obviously we only get together once in a while, but everything is done these days by email. And when someone submits a project, and the press has published poetry, literary fiction, mysteries, romances, chick lit, I'm trying to think if there's anything. They just haven't done nonfiction. It's all been either fiction or poetry. And so all of the editors read, there's five of us. There were five of us anyway when the press started. And three of the five had to agree that the project was worthy for a request for the full manuscript to go out. And then again, the five would read the full manuscript. And again, three of the five would have to say, yes, the press should publish this. But I have to say that that rarely happened. If the writing sample that came, the 20 or 50 pages that were sent in first, were good enough that three people thought it was good enough for the press, most often the full book was. But there were caveats with that. And that was that the author had to agree to have their manuscript professionally copy edited. And then one of the five editors, usually one of the three who plumped for the book, who said, yes, this, we should do this, would be assigned to that author, especially if they were first-time author, and would shepherd them through the printing process and copy editing and everything like that. And so there's sort of a quality control end to it, because anyone can publish a book these days, which is sort of a double-edged sword. It's wonderful, but it also makes it very difficult for readers to understand that not just because a book is out there and it's published, it might not be a great book to read. And so we were trying to, not in terms of content necessarily, but just in terms of quality, try to have some sort of quality control on it. And so that's what we would do. We would never leave it to one person's opinion, because everybody has different feelings about different forms of writing. Sure. So three of the five of us would have to approve the person, and then we would invite them to publish. But the press is sort of, I won't say winding down, but everyone who started it now is getting older. And so we're probably not going to take newer authors any longer. The people who have already published with us will continue to publish, like they'll probably continue to bring my books out, but under their imprint. But I'm not sure that the head, the girl who started it, the actual publisher, Lauren Small, she's just brought out her third novel. It's about Nuremberg trials, fascinating book. And I'm not sure that she feels her writing is taking off more. And I'm not sure that she feels she has the time to take on new writers right now. That's sort of something we're talking about. But that's how the whole thing started. And that was probably about in 2010, I want to say. So, it's been around for a while. And of course, it's nice to be able to have an imprint to publish under. And it's nice to feel that there are people who have sort of not approved your work, but see the worth of your work before it hits print, and to help you in that process. Because if you've never done it before, it can be very daunting. I mean, I don't think people realize how many times when I talk to writing students or do a book event at a library. This past May, I was invited to my hometown, Floral Park, Long Island, and I spoke to the fifth and sixth grade classes in the school that I went to, the elementary school I went to. And they threw it open for questions after I gave a little prepared speech. And the question I get asked the most often, and don't you know these young students who were, you know, going to be taking creative writing soon, all ask the same question is, you know, well, tell us about your process in terms of once you write the book, how long does it take, and then getting it into print. And when I said to them, well, the book probably gets rewritten at least three times, and it takes about 18 months to 2 years from the first draft till it's in print, they were like, what? You know, they couldn't believe it. And so I said to them, I know, when I said to them, but you have to think about that. Your first draft should never be what's handed in, right? And your teachers will tell you that. That goes for an essay, right? In school. But you know, your first draft is that lump of clay. You're getting the story out, what Annie Lamott calls shitty first drafts, right? You're just getting your story out. And that's never going to be what makes it into print. And then you take that lump of clay and you get it beautiful. You had asked me something about writing advice, the best writing advice I ever got. And it was Phyllis, it was P.G. James. And she said to me, never forget, the real writing gets done in revision. Because she agreed with me on that first draft is your idea and your storyline. But the real writing gets done when you take that and you make it something beautiful. So...
Sure. I love that. And it's funny that you would, you know, speak to revision, because some people, you know, sort of loathe that word. They dread that part of the process. But I read a book recently, and then I spoke to Jess Lowry. She was my last interview, and she wrote a book called Rewrite Your Life, which is basically taking, you know, real life experiences and emotions and using that to inform your fiction. And she had a segment in the book about revision and how she loves that process. And she sees it, you know, as an opportunity to just make everything better. And, you know, she actually wrote that revision is literally seeing something with fresh or new eyes. And I know what revision means, but I never just thought of it in such simple but profound terms before until she actually wrote it and then said it. And it's like light bulb goes off. Like, it's not something you're afraid of, but it's really an opportunity to just mold something, you know, into what it's meant to be. And so to follow up on, you know, best advice that you ever got, because P.D. James is pretty great to be taking advice from, but let me ask you this. What is the best advice that you never got and had to learn for yourself through actually doing all of the work?
In thinking about that, I would say that I didn't realize at the beginning how early on in a book's life or journey you need to start creating interest in it. So for instance, so I've just finished the first draft of Death in the Orchard, the third Nora book, and I have to let it sit and percolate a little bit, but I'll probably toward the end of the summer pick it up now and do my first big revision, and I'll actually rewrite the book. And now that I know what the book is going to be and what the title is going to be, I'll start working with the book designer and we'll have a cover for that book, even though I don't anticipate the book being in print until next year, but we'll have a cover for that book around the holidays, probably. Then I can already start promoting and saying, you know, in process, look for this book coming. And you start to create interest, especially if you have readers who are interested in your series and are looking for the next one. I didn't know that at the beginning. I didn't know that with my first book. And I had to learn that along the way, that the sooner that you can create buzz about a book, the more your readers are going to be excited and they're going to be looking for it. And, so that would be something I would say that I had to learn. And now I'm very much more involved in that promotion process. You know, that's sort of the double-edged sword for a writer. It takes away from writing time, but if you don't tell people your book is out there, how are they going to look for it, to read it? And so, you know, you have to pay a certain amount of attention to it. And the earlier you get something that you're pretty sure is going to be out there, even if the title ends up changing down the road, if you can get a cover going that you like, and I just think it gives people something to look forward to. So that's how I would answer that question, is you can't start your promotion early enough.
That's a point well taken. As you said, you know, it is all about the buzz. And the funny thing is, you know, a lot of first-time authors think that they've, you know, written and revised the book and it's done. And then you realize, oh Lord, the job has just begun, because now, even if you're traditionally
starting,
you need to be out there pushing it. It's crazy, but it really is two different jobs: write the book and then market it and promote it and find time to write another one. And, you know, speaking of writing other books, I am going to ask you, I think that you've sort of teased three different books: the next, you know, Nora book and the other series and a standalone. But if you want to, one more time, just give us a little brief heads up as to what people can, you know, start to anticipate now, please feel free.
Okay. Well, I don't have a title for even a working title for the, I call it the Cornwall book yet, and that will be down the road. The standalone, and I'm not sure where that's going to fall, if that will be after this next Trudy or after the next Nora, is the working title is 11 Days, and I doubt that will change. And that's the Agatha Christie spa book. It will be set in Yorkshire at the Harrogate Spa. And I'm doing the research on that now and character development, but only in a very mild way. What I'm really working on in the next book that will be in print is the third Trudy book. And that title is Death at the Orchard. The first two books took place in Manhattan, where Trudy works. And at the end of the second book, she asked Ned, the NYPD detective who she started to date, if he would come home with her to, quote unquote, meet her family, but really help her try to figure out what happened to her father, who died when she was 16. And she's always felt it was ruled an accident, and she's always felt he was murdered. And indeed, it does turn out to be a murder. But while she's home for that week with him, someone else, her family owns an apple orchard, and someone else is murdered on their property, a worker. And her brother falls under suspicion. So again, I've got these two cases going at the same time. So they're there in an unofficial capacity, haven't told her family that they're kind of looking into her father's death. Right. Meanwhile, everybody's running around because, you know, someone's been killed on their property. And so so that's Death at the Orchard. And it possibly could be out next summer, but more likely next fall. Sure. We'll see what happens, you know, in terms of family life and COVID and everything else.
Well, that's suspense for
you,
right? But you have given us much to look forward to. And I mean, the nice thing is, in the meantime, readers can enjoy the evening's amethyst. And, you know, I can say that if people pick up this book and they haven't read the earlier books, they're going to want to go back and read the first four, because it stands alone beautifully, but you have these characters that you fall in love with and you're going to want to meet them. So
I appreciate that, John. I appreciate you hosting me very much. You know, we were talking before about the marketing, and another thing that I've come up with, which is new, I just want to throw this out there, is that there's, Nora has a little dog, I told you. And
yes,
so we've created, Typo. And so we've got this character called Typo's Glitch that has his own Twitter page now and is doing his own posts. And so sometimes you have to think outside the box and, you know, to create sort of an adjunct thing for that. So, but thank you very much for having me. I really appreciate it. And I've enjoyed speaking with you very much.
Well, thank you for being here. And you know what? The dog will be the thing that breaks you out of the mold, because people just go crazy for pets. So if anything's going to do it, you know, it'll probably be Typo the dog on Twitter. So go look that up. Thank you, Marty.
There you go.
You are a delight. And Evening's Amethyst, people should pick it up. It's a terrific read.
That's it for this episode of Central Booking. Thanks for watching, and be sure to subscribe to our channel so you don't miss a thing.